first expedition to Confinius Probe and 1 Brelyahalski Code EX73315 Explanation of the Universe. This story is set in another universe in a world that resembles the Earth with beings that resemble humans with some differences. Those humans have features that set them apart from us, but at a first glance it's hard to tell. Their history is the same as ours. They have nations and cultures, but also something called nations unions, like small groups of United Nations that govern the group of nations / countries / states that are part of it. One nation is the leader and the rest follows. Their technological advancement is about the same as ours, maybe a couple of decades ahead of us, but not by much. Any tech that we don't have is very experimental for them. Like the small black hole delivery system or the Solonet, internet that uses sunlight to spread information instead of cables. The farther you are from the sun, the slower the connection, of course. This makes it pretty useless at the edge of the solar system.
This is Captain Halski. Date of recording is 10/15/4891. This is almost the first year into the mission and we're getting close to our target. The planet known as Confinius, located in the outskirts of our own solar system. The voyage has been a bit rocky, mostly due to differences between crew members regarding cultural, linguistic and historical reasons. Ever since we, the Apatsian Commonwealth, decided to collaborate with the unstable Khaleesian Federation, they've been a pain to us as they've been among themselves. The Euskelian and Plafardian have been at each other's throats since day one because of simple dialectal issues that quite frankly at this point are getting somewhat tiresome. Luckily the Khaleesian coordinator Ernest Todetch has always managed to keep the animosities at bay. I know that we had to form this alliance because of the economical toll this whole project took on the whole of the Commonwealth, and I swear that I am doing everything I can to make the mission a success. Some days ago, to my amazement, the Khaleesian buried their hatchets as soon as they tasted the Apatsian throat of fire drink that we are known for. I am of course talking about the original from Yupitz and not that cheap copy from Yarnesi. Jokes aside, we've been quite successful in approaching the planet of Confinius and are estimated to arrive in 6 more weeks. The gravitational fields have been fluctuating the closer we get to our target, but all in all, it's been easy sailing. As for the black hole emitters, they've been working like a charm. Deliveries are quick and we can use the Solonet without interruptions. Apparently the Khaleesians are celebrating the Four Kings revival in Khaleesuna next month, the 6th day of the 6th week of the 6th month, so the Khaleesian crew is making preparations already. There are no children in this crew, so no big spectacle is planned. Although we've heard rumors that the Plafardians are planning a party with lots of red wine from the River Blood region, a real treat that us Yupatsians can't wait to enjoy. Even though we don't know any of the Plafardian dances, we still enjoy seeing them in action. Halski out. This is Captain Halski. Date of recording is 10/25/4891. This week's report is a bit unusual. We've been approaching Confinius as planned, but space is getting stranger and stranger. The blackness or space has been getting a tint of dark purple and we suffered a shutdown of the gravitational field, but our Yarnesi and Euskalian engineers have reconfigured the field in only 8 hours. What started as a dangerous situation developed into a deep exchange of scientific data between the two groups that, despite speaking Yopish and Kalish, surprised us all by quickly learning from each other and putting that knowledge into action. All in all, this mission is shaping up to be a unifying endeavor. Perhaps we all can live together in our small world close to our small orange star. Yon anchor, my first mate, has started to pick up some Kalish, for a strict military man from Yarnesi that's pretty impressive. I still don't know the need for a military team aboard this scientific vessel. I mean, who is gonna attack us? Unless the other big nations of our world were here. I know for a fact that an acquaintance from the eastern nation of Vidmitsk said that their leader nation Politivska was also preparing a similar mission to ours. If the Asavic Union of Nations gets the biff for us, then it'll spell trouble for us, since the peace treaty is only valid inside the sphere of influence of our native world, which probably means that anything this far out is fair game to anyone. I guess I see why I need these military men amongst my crew. Even though us Yapatsian have the most advanced technology of our world, we're glad to have the Khaleesian numbers at our side, even though they're shorter built, they're faster and more agile than our tall muscular men. I believe this to be a good mix. Halsky out. This is Captain Halsky. Date of recording is 10/3/5/4891. This week's report is pretty much uneventful. We've been getting closer and closer to Confinius, and we have passed its farthest moon, Urana. It is mostly ice and rock. Our science team picked up a good amount of samples from it and have already sent it home via the black hole emitters. It's a pretty ingenious invention. Our world doesn't have the energy capacity to open full-fledged wormholes to send ships. But we have enough energy capacity to open a small 5x5-inch wormhole that can only be active for a couple of minutes at a time. This gives us a chance to send and receive items almost instantly. The downside is that it takes one full week to recharge it with the energy consumption of the rest of the ship's systems. We don't dare to push it beyond its capacity. Although a Skahlian physicist had some ideas on how to make the wormhole wider, I won't allow him to do it just yet. We don't know what the tests from the moon will tell us. We can't risk sending bigger things through the wormhole. I am genuinely impressed though with how easy this Uskahlian understood our top secret science. I'll keep a closer eye on him. In other news, Khaleesians and Plafardians challenged Yapatsians and Yarnesians to a game of foots. After a long discussion on what rules to employ, Yarnesian or world rules, they decided on 4 half times with intermittent rule set. The game got interrupted when a Yarnesian player accidentally knocked out a Khaleesian player. Due to size difference, the game had to be postponed since the Khaleesian player fractured his femur. Luckily for him, Yapit's medicinal technology has come far in bone and muscle repairs. He is going to leave the medical bay this weekend, around day 17. I have been talking to Yon about the Asavic Union of Nations situation. He wasn't that worried since military intelligence suggests that their most advanced ships can't come close to our technology. Even though they've colonized 4 of our planet's 9 moons, they are no threat as their moon bases are specialized in agricultural and biological development due to the food shortages their nations suffer during those hard eastern winters. Halsky out. This is Captain Halsky. Date of recording is 10/4/5/4891. Today we reached the second of the 3 Confinian moons, Pehei. This moon is really peculiar because apart from having the usual ice and rock surface, it also has some seas of purple fog. Our scientific team concentrated on taking samples and examining them on board. They found out that the purple fog was in fact a purple substance frozen that wasn't native to this moon. It came from further in, probably Moon 1 or the planet itself. I have alerted them to take extra precautions and to store the samples in the southern part of the ship that is completely separated from the main living and working areas for the safety of the rest of the crew. I can't have any contaminants messing with the crew. I'm their captain and the one who is responsible for every single one of them, no matter if they are Khaleesian Federation or Commonwealth. We are together in this ship as one crew. I also went and investigated the Uskahlian physicist that piqued my interest. Apparently he is the Federation genius Robocopewan that was assumed dead in action by the end of the Federation Unification War. This man developed several groundbreaking theories on matter and its effect on three-dimensional space. The Khaleesians lost a lot of men trying to catch him while he evaded them easily in the Plafardian flatlands. Plafardians and Uskahlians have been mortal enemies since time immemorial and probably were the ones that started the war, in which all 21 Khaleesian nations got involved in one way or another, until of course the nation of Khaleesuna united 18 nations against Uskilehun Plafardo to end the madness and created the first nations union based on ethnic, cultural and linguistic similarities. The Commonwealth followed quickly to keep up with this new development. Even though the other 15 nations' unions aren't as advanced as the Commonwealth or as numerous as the Federation, it is my belief that only one group should take the lead in our world. I hope it is the Commonwealth, indeed. I hope that this will lead to a united world. It's hard to imagine. But if we make it, maybe the dangers of space won't stop humanity from reaching even the furthest stars in our galaxy. I believe we can do it. Halsky out. This is Captain Halsky. Date of recording is 10/5/5/4891. We're stationed around the closest moon of Confinius, Co-A. This moon looked very strange while we were approaching it. Half of the moon is methane seas and ice, while the other half is covered in this purple ice that we found on the second moon. The difference is that this purple ice is really concentrated and much darker than the one found on the middle moon Pehei. The sky outside our ship is also getting a heavier tint of purple, which we now have deduced must be the purple ice coloring the space around the area of influence of Confinius. Our science team has been dispatched to the moon and are setting up laboratories to examine this substance in detail. Our military group has been busy with setting up possible scenarios that would require their intervention. Hopefully that won't be necessary, but reality differs from fantasy in that sense. We never know what will happen next. Jan Anker, first mate and military leader, has been really busy and I miss our talks with a cup of Galimbrian coffee. Right now our crew of 30 is well and ready for anything that may come our way. Ernest Todech went through our crew and he made me aware of something I hadn't thought of. Robocopowan looks younger than he should be. At first I didn't understand what he meant by it, but then I realized what he meant when I saw his birth date. Seeing that the average lifespan of a human is 30 to 32 years, this man was born in 17/3/5/4829. He is over 60 years old. How is it possible for a man to live double that of an average human? Now that I think about it, of course he should be this old. The Federation Wars ended over 40 years ago. That's far beyond my life of 15 going on 16 years old. But this still doesn't explain how he can still be alive. The Federation hasn't been fully honest with the Commonwealth about this crew member and his objective with this mission. I have talked with Anker about this and he will be keeping an extra eye out. Halsky out. This is Captain Halsky. Date of recording is 10/6/5/4891. The scientific team has been down on the moon Co-A for about 19 days. That's 2 days short of a week. They began setting up the provisional base 2 days after my last weekly report, and on the 12th day of the fifth week they themselves went down there to start examining the purple mass of ice. 8 days into their study of the purple mass they detected several anomalies that normal mass doesn't show. I will try to explain it as I understood it, recognizing I'm not a physicist or chemist at all, as my specialization is psychological and mental health. But apparently as energy can be condensed down to mass, that's how they explained it anyway, apparently so can other forces be condensed into mass or something in its likeness. This purple substance is seemingly gravity condensed into mass. This is also something that completely blew my mind, since they had to explain several times that in order to create this mass you needed tons of gravity in one single point. When I inquired about if it was a black hole that did this, they smiled. A black hole doesn't have enough energy to turn gravity into mass. Oh no, but a supermassive black hole could. According to physicists Robocopowan and Alder Roxwell, Yapetsi and Prodigy from southwestern Yapits, the amount of purple mass around Confinius is such that, if their calculations are true, nothing but a supermassive black hole has enough mass to cause this. This means that by some natural, or not so natural, way a wormhole opened on the surface of Confinius with one end on the planet and the other end at the center of our galaxy, and this spread across the surroundings of this planet. This makes total sense now. That's why the closest moons are colored purple. The space around it is tinted purple and the planet itself looks like an eyeball with a purple iris. I have ordered the geological team to detect any changes to the moon Koa and if possible read data from Beihei. I expect a report by next week's weekly transmission to you on our home world. Next week is also the last month of autumn, which means the old traditional Yapetsian month of evening starts. Kali's seen celebrate only the last week, but we dedicate it to the people, days and loves we've lost. Theirs is a happy feast, ours is a dark and pensive time. We of Yapetsian culture decided that out of the 6 weeks of the month, we would only celebrate 5 of them, with the 5th weekend the Kali's seens joining us in the end of evening banquet, where we eat the symbolic rabbit, reminding us that anything can disappear fast, so don't wait too long for something you want to do, get or accomplish. It will be a fantastic month, with sadness turning into a week-long party. Halski out. This is Captain Halski. Date of recording is 10/16/4891. Today marks the first week of the month of evening. But as we are working on what could be the most important mission to humankind, we're not celebrating or letting it affect us in our working days. We've agreed to keep both celebrations, evening and Four Kings, on weekends to not disturb our workflow. The geological team, comprised of Ervilia Heum, from the Northern Commonwealth Nation of Borealia, and Nail Grossi, from the Eastern Federation Nation of Plafardia, came with a report on anomalies they could have found in or around the two moons that had been affected by the purple substance. Their report explains that the ejection of this substance was so forceful and concentrated that it emulated the same movement as water does when it is propelled out from a hole while the pressure is enormous. This beam of matter drilled a hole through the moon Koa and painted the second moon Beihei. The third and outmost moon Urana wasn't affected, possibly by being further away in its orbit by the time the beam moved through its orbit. So at the moment the moon we're currently examining is as hollow as an apple. After removing its core, melted methane filled those holes and turned into ice. That's why we didn't see the trajectory of the beam until now. The expulsion of energy must have been tremendous, and we're getting a bit scared as to what this all means, who or what could have started this chain reaction. After dismissing the team, I was visited by Ernest Odech, who was concerned about what Alvarian Kavana, a Kalisian soldier that got his femur fractured a couple of weeks ago, told him. He made a full recovery and was pretty confused about a situation he was involved in. Apparently Robert Gopawan came to his room with these strange tales about how he could help him to never get injured again in his life if he wanted. At first, Alvarian laughed at Robert's crazy tale, but as he explained the whole story, Robert pulled a knife and cut himself on the arm. Alvarian was befuddled. Being a soldier and a peacekeeper in the Sintic kingdoms, he had seen worse things, but to see a man cut himself only to see the wound close with the movement of the knife, it looked as if the skin was a stack of papers the knife just went between. Robert told him that if he wanted this he could have it too, but at a price. Ernest then told me that the price wasn't specified, but that we should isolate Robert as soon as possible, because if Alvarian's story was true, then we cannot trust Robert. Something is telling me that Ernest knows something I don't, and I don't like it. Possibly they've brought Federation conflicts aboard much worse than those at the start of the expedition. I need to keep an eye open. Halski out. This is Captain Halski. Date of recording is 10/26/4891. After a long week, we decided to close the laboratory and start making our way to Confinius. We are aware that tensions in our world are getting worse thanks to the dwindling resources, but we are aware that exploring the origin of the anomaly on this planet is by far the most important thing right now. Anchor, Todech and myself have been discussing the slow fragmentation of our world, and we have come to the agreement that even if our nations went to war against each other, this ship will remain united. It is widely known that a small group is easier to keep united than a large union of anything. That's the reason the older empires fell. They crumbled under their own weight, so to speak. We still have some days left until we touch upon the position above the purple hole on Confinius. I have also put Robert Gopawan in the arrest since this part of the mission is really critical and we cannot doubt the man next to us. At the moment he is locked up in his quarters and it has been disconnected from the Solarnet as well as the rest of the ship's internal network. According to the soldiers that handled him, he was screaming something about how we all will fail if he isn't with us down on the planet. He is saying that only he has the knowledge to activate the portal, whatever that means. I will send Anchor to do an interrogation on him in a couple of days. I just need to read through the mental profile of the crew soldiers so they won't doubt for a moment to hold Robert down whenever and if he wants to do something strange. Our capacities are limited and a restraining field would be too taxing on our energy systems. So we are going old school and we will use ropes and chains to keep him from moving. Knowing what we know about him, being practically unable to get hurt, we need to restrain his movement as much as possible. Add number 001 to the report. I have chosen Selbit Biner, Yepetsian Sniper, and Dahlia Oltiz, Khaleesian Sniper, to aid Anchor in his interrogation. Their mental stamina is the biggest plus for an assignment like this one. Also their bodily stamina, since their speciality requires them to hold the same position sometimes days in a row just to get that perfect shot. They have been informed that they will be needed in a couple of days, but nothing else has been told yet. We don't want Robert's sympathizers to know about this interrogation as it could divide the ship and even mutiny could ensue if I am not careful on how I handle this. A mutiny this far from home could result in death for the losing half of a conflict. Halsky out. This is Captain Halsky. Date of recording is 18/26/4891. This is an extra report as we are still in week 2 of the 6th month. But it is imperative that I send the whole interrogation of Robert to Command Inupiaz. Here is the whole conversation in 3D video graphics with original sound.
Start of video 001 interrogation of Robert Gopawan. We are inside a small room with one table and two chairs facing each other on either side of the table. On one sits Jan Anchor and on the other sits Robert Gopawan. Biner is standing to the left behind of Robert and Oltiz is standing on the right behind Robert. Anchor opens a notepad in his personal tablet and starts recording the voice into text in the notepad application.
This is Jan Anchor of the State of Jan Asiacon Nation of the Commonwealth. The subject of the interrogation is Robert Gopawan, Uskalian physicist that somehow has kept himself young beyond his 60s when a normal human lifespan is roughly 30 years. The subject has alluded to knowing how to keep young and unharmed through the years by offering the same to others in the crew. At the moment we don't know who else has been offered the same thing. First of all, how are you doing, Mr. Robert?
Robert looks tired and not amused to be here. He looks away from Jan and says,
"See, oh, be wink malprio."
Oltiz jumps in and translates from Kalish to Yopish.
"I'm good, asshole. I can't translate wink. It's a new Skellian word."
Anchor smiles and sits back on his chair and says,
"So that's how we are going to do it, eh? If you want to be a wet blanket, I have several things that can address that. You do feel pain, right? Even if you are incapable of getting hurt?"
Robert turns his head fast to look at Anchor. Biner reacts fast and catches a small needle flying through the air. Biner says,
"Was about to go long wong air. Looks like a parasite needle."
Jan Anchor squints his eyes.
"So you want to do it like this, eh? I've got news for you, Sonny. Nobody tries to attack a Jan Asian Marine without consequences. Miss Oltiz, connect him to the high voltage apparatus. I think our friend won't be telling us anything through politeness. Let's see if he responds to more. Extreme persuasion."
Oltiz connects one cable to Robet's left hand and the other to his right hand. Anchor sighs and looks straight into Robet's eyes.
"Listen, I will give you a last chance to do this in a civilized manner. Will you cooperate with me and get this over fast?"
Robet thinks about it for a second and smiles at Jan.
"Nam Cree Okasero I see."
Anchor turns to Oltiz waiting for a translation into Yopatsian, but she is already untying Robert while Biner tries to hold Anchor seated. Jan Anchor starts screaming.
"What is the meaning of this? Dahlia Oltiz. Don't untie him. Biner, let me go.
Sorry, big cake. Brrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrr
Kalish to Dalia Ultis.
You what's up with him?
Didn't you know? This guy has the sniper world record, an impossible record that no human can do.
So he's not human?
Oh, he's an android human. I figured it out when we were preparing for this interrogation. I tried to knock him out with the voltage apparatus while he was holding the cables before the interrogation. He didn't even flinch. By the way, what does the Euskelian word wink mean?
Oh, it means foreigner with bad intentions.
I thought it was something more severe. Do you have my necklace ready?
Robet shushed her and pointed at the camera in the room.
Ha there. I forgot about those.
Let's get the others and make an exit.
End of video.
At this moment we have 6 members out of our crew of 30 missing. Here is the list for command to examine and maybe give us more information that the psychic evaluations haven't. Alder Roxwell, Yepetsian physicist Mac Flegg, Yarnesian engineer Jai Halston, Yarnesian engineer Robert Copewan, Euskalian physicist Lomena Petruan, Euskalian engineer Dalia Ultis, Khaleesian soldier. It is alarming to see that out of 4 engineers, 3 are missing, as well as both physicists and 1 soldier. My fear is that somehow Robert convinced these people that they would get the same longevity and immunity to physical damage. In that case, we could be in danger aboard this ship. Selbitbiner has been repaired. Dalia Ultis fumbled with his memory cores and created a command that would disable his higher functions. With 3 engineers by her side, it would have been pretty simple to make him execute simple commands. The only engineer left is Lefru Koilean, another Euskalian. I have decided we can trust him since he was born and raised in Borrelia and only acquired membership as a Khaleesian engineer right before departure. He feels guilty of being the one who translated between engineers and teaching both sides how to communicate better with each other. We will be keeping stricter records of who goes where and what systems are being used. I am afraid we will have to rely heavily on Lefru's skills to keep the ship running and also detect intrusion into the systems. Halsky out. This is Captain Halsky. Date of recording is 10/4/6/4891. My apologies for missing the week 3 report, but we've been very busy trying to decipher what the rebel crew is trying to do. We have an idea of their whereabouts, but to put it simple, this ship is too damn big for a crew of 30. I believe that the plan to turn a Khaleesian luxury cruise ship that only was meant to travel between moons into an inter-solar system vessel, the first ever that can travel between planets in the system, was a bad idea. Now we need to search a ship the size of a small town that normally is manned by a crew of 500 for 3,000 guests is a bit too much. If we'd had more time to plan this more thoroughly, we could have gotten a better suited ship. But crying about it won't solve the issue. I need to find solutions to the problems that have arisen. We are a few days from reaching Confinius, and as the ship is putting itself into orbit, I have briefed the entire crew of this situation, and Jan together with Ernest have been interviewing each crew member to help me set a psychological profile adjusted to the latest changes in crew composition. The 3 Plafardian crew members are eager to help, maybe a little too eager. This goes back to the rivalry between Euskalians and Plafardians. I have to keep an extra eye on them so our only engineer Lefru isn't attacked and disabled by a misdirected attack. I have assigned Ched Bunton, Yarnesian martial arts master, together with Beto Ray, Plafardian martial arts master, to keep Lefru Koilean safe from unwanted attacks. They've been told to not let anyone know about their assignment to hopefully keep their protected image incognito so that the crew can return to some kind of normality. I think some might be doubting my decision of putting a Plafardian in charge of the personal security of an Euskalian. The thing is, I believe in the good of people, and Beto looks like a man that puts duty first. The ship is holding fine with the changes in gravity, as the planet's center of mass isn't anymore at the core. It changed to the purple dot on the northern hemisphere. This has resulted in a tedious manual calculation of mass since the automatic systems weren't designed for an off-center gravitational focal point. The fact that both our physicists are missing doesn't make the whole ordeal go any quicker. We will try and get a geostationary orbit to keep the ship at one point above the planet. Halsky out. This is Captain Halsky. Date of recording is 10/5/6/4891. We have reached the geostationary orbit we wanted and are placed right above the purple circle. Ground zero if you want, and are getting ready to touch down on the planet. 1 hour into reaching the stable point above, a lifeboat left the southern part of the probe and we could scan it making its way down to the surface. Our breakaway crew has landed on the surface, without spacesuits, without oxygen. This doesn't bode well for them, or to be perfectly honest, this doesn't bode well for us. What could they be up to? Yon Anchor has taken all 10 military crew members as well as the Apatsian Dr. Daniel Printon. The Calesian Dr. Rene Braga is to stay in the ship with the science team in case something happens to the crew on board. Lefruit Coilowen has been taken by Anchor to in case his expertise is needed versus the three engineers. I don't see what Lefruit can do versus Alder and Robert. Two geniuses in their own right. I guess I am just getting frustrated knowing the mental stress these soldiers will be under. Hopefully they can capture the rebel crew without bloodshed. I wouldn't want to have to report any deaths to command. Lefru looked really scared going down with Anchor, but Yon told him he would keep him safe as long as he stayed behind him at all times and didn't disobey orders. Alvarian Kavana, Calesian, and Rovina Nudart, Yarnesian, are top trackers that are already down on the surface tracking the other team. Being a tracker you are used to fast movement in light gear. But what they lack in gear they compensate in survivability. Last time I heard from them they were making their way towards the lifeboat that the rebel crew landed on the surface. It is parked about 2 kilometers outside an enormous crater that is filled with the purple matter that probably has its origin in the center of said crater. They came close to it and began reconnaissance. A couple of minutes into the endeavor the communication was distorted and they had to retreat to a boulder that was far away enough for them to call to us and they said that both radio signals and gravity are distorted near and inside the crater. Yon Anchor and the rest of the crew landed some 3 kilometers from the tracker's last known position. The radio distortion and the gravity distortion are getting worse and we can't keep up with them. As I am recording this report Yon and the tracker's communications can't reach us in orbit but the last thing I heard was Yon Anchor and Rovina talking so I think they can at least rendezvous with each other. I am preparing the science team to be ready at any moment to help the team on the ground in any way possible. The geological team, Ervilia Hiam, Borian, and Nail Grossi, Plafardian, talked to me about using the Horizon Range drones that use the magnetic field of a planet or moon to communicate. They have 4 at the moment and I told them to teach our chemistry team, Norbert Mafelnron, Borian, and Palmia Sella, Plafardian, on how to use them. We might get a way to help with these drones. Even though they only have a camera and a single arm each, they could be very useful. I will update as soon as I have more on this case. Halsky out. This is Captain Halsky. Date of recording is 11/5/6/4891. We've continued to monitor the rebel crew's activities. Yon Anchor managed to send us information through a Horizon drone thanks to Lefru's engineering skills. Robert and the rest have been disassembling the lifeboat and are building something at a big stone arch that looks far beyond archaic. They've been hooking up cables to it and are reinforcing some parts with the hull of the lifeboat. They don't use space suits or anything like that. This leads me to believe they all have the preservation technology. We need to stop them. I think they will try to open the portal again. This could be really bad. We've been calculating the projected trajectory of the beam. It would hit our own world if they triggered it. They could erase our civilization from existence. I have sent an alert to you at command. I hope you get this message in time so you can take whatever necessary measures you need to take in order to preserve our way of life in case this event is worse than I can imagine. I have also sent a warning to each nation's union so they too can take any action needed. As I wrote this report, things still continued to happen. Fortunately for us, the drones keep their pilots updated on what's happening all the time thanks to the magnetospheric communication technology. I can see what their virtual screens see. Even though they see everything as if they were there, I'm resigned to watching it on my command screen, not as immersive but good enough. I have four eyes in the sky at the moment, the two more experienced, the geological team, are on duty covering what the enemy is doing. While the more inexperienced crew, the chemistry team, are tasked with communicating with and supporting our team. The information, voice and video are one way only, surface to ship, so all I can do is watch and pray that everything works out good. I have a lot of faith in Yon Anchor. He is one of Yon SI's finest Marines. He is the role model for a whole nation's Marine Corps. The chemistry team is doing a great job relaying messages between troops and trackers. I think they're planning to strike soon. My question is if they'll do it before or after Robet activates the Confinian portal. Who could have thought that this would happen a couple of years ago when we first discovered the gravitational anomalies? If I remember correctly, it was Alder Roxwell that brought this to the Royal Order of Science and Technology, ROAST. This is of course the reason he came along this voyage, as the official ROAST envoy. Now that I think about it, this anomaly was first discovered by the multi-talented Vidmitskian triplets, Daniel, Vasil and Kirill Vishnevsky. Both intelligent and strong, they give the impression of being genetically modified. With the Asavic Union you never know, to be honest. Oh, my God. I just realized that the Khaleesian sent Robet as their own envoy. This means that they knew all along he would do this mutiny. They want any discoveries made here to benefit the Khaleesian Federation. But the crew didn't know. It seems that only the Euskelian crew, aside from Lefru, were aware of this plan. So this means that they not only betrayed the Commonwealth but the Federation too. Is Euskile trying to go rogue? I don't understand. I'll send another report as soon as there's any news, and if you have any idea on what's happening between the Federation nations, I'd greatly appreciate it. Halski out. This is Captain Halski. Date of recording is 12/5/6/4891. I've received your information and I understand what must be done. This is something a captain isn't allowed to do, but I need to deliver this message to Yon Anchor as soon as possible. I don't trust in the abilities of anyone else doing this, so I need to see this through myself. I have connected the four drones to broadcast everything live through our encrypted line through Solanit. That was the fastest and easiest way for me to facilitate to you in command what may be the last mission of Brelia Halski and my crew. I need to set a stop to this at once and hopefully before anyone gets killed. I have put on my space suit, which is heavier than I remember. The rest of the crew, four drone pilots and the doctor, will stay behind while I will pilot a lifeboat down to the surface. I've left Ernost Todec with the responsibility of being the captain in my absence, a thing that will revert as soon as I or Yon step once again inside the Probant One again. Even though he's Khaleesian, I trust him enough to give him command. I've pinpointed the location of Yon and crew and have decided to land a few kilometers behind him so the rebel crew isn't alerted to my movement. I want to avoid ruckus for as long as possible. I send to you one final request, command. Tell my daughter that I love her lots and that Mum really hopes to come back. But just in case something goes wrong and they activate the Confinian portal, Sarah Halski, Mum loves you.
Start a video feed. The drone is following Yon Anchor.
Alright crew, you know the deal? We've been rehearsing the plan for a day now. If anyone doesn't know what to do, then I'm sorry, but I'll have to leave you out.
The whole crew nodded to show they were ready.
Okay, let's move fast to the border of the crater and keep your heads low. The trackers found us already a spot from where we can storm in without being noticed. The drones will show us when we can move by gaining altitude to signal free movement. If they for any reason should drop height fast, you all will find a spot to hide behind. Remember, the rebel crew has the devices that keeps them unharmed and immortal. If we want this to succeed, then remember to tie them up fast and no use of guns or weapons, as it won't matter.
The transmission changes to a drone hidden near the portal and we can hear the rebel crew planning.
So,
Robet starts.
As soon as we wrist toward the portal to a perfect circle, we will commence with the activation process. It is pretty simple. I have two stasis grenades here. They work in the same way the necklaces that protect your molecular integrity do. The difference is that these grenades, invented by the great Elder Oxwell, will create a bubble of molecular integrity preserving anything inside its area of effect. But for the plan to work, I need one of you activating the portal and another one ready with the grenade. I will hold the second grenade to time it correctly.
Are you sure your calculations take into consideration all variables?
Said Max Flegg.
I mean, you couldn't possibly know the strength of the supermassive black hole.
Robet didn't react and said,
that's why we have two. The first one will stop the beam, the second one will keep the portal open and active. If it falls at the right angle, then we will have approximately 10 minutes to get to the lifeboat before the whole planet is drawn into the singularity caused by the frozen beam. But if the first grenade fails, then the planet won't be drawn into the portal and the size of it won't be the diameter of the planet, but only the diameter of the portal itself, big enough for a full-grown Yapitzian.
Jaya Halston jumped in.
It is a good idea to keep the gravity beam static. If it got out of hand, we would probably snipe our world and maybe some of our nine moons. This could mean the end of our species if we mess up the first grenade.
Robet turned his head and looked at the horizon.
Yeah.
He said with an empty tone.
All right. Everything is hooked up and ready.
Yelled Lomina Petter when.
The cable will disconnect from the lifeboat as soon as it leaves the ground. The opening sequence can be started from the portal itself now.
The screen changes to John Anchor and the soldiers ready to engage.
Biner.
John calls.
Shoot Robet Compwin in the head now before they activate the portal.
Biner aims and shoots Robet's head off with a clean shot.
I don't understand.
Says Beto Ray.
Where's the blood?
Robet's body stands there without a head and you can see sparks fly out of his neck. At the same time, while Beto is amazed, Lefru sneaks close to him, shoots Beto in the head and turns on the explosives in the backpack. Henri Chardon, explosives expert.
Everybody get down.
Henri screams as he tosses the backpack into the air. The rebel crew turn the power to the portal on, and while the portal opens, Jaya Halston loses her balance thanks to the explosion and misses the grenade. The beam shoots throughout the solar system on its way to the home world. The military team rushes in and tries to wrestle and apprehend the rebel crew while the body of Robet Compwin throws the grenade that stabilized the portal. Borrelia Halski runs into the group but is too late. The stasis grenade was thrown in such a way that not only the portal was stabilized, but everybody are frozen in time save for Captain Halski, of course.
This is Borrelia Halski, to anyone that can hear me. We are stuck on this planet. My ship, the Probant One, has been split in half by the beam. The crew aboard is presumed KIA, and the crew on the planet have been frozen in time. I'm the only survivor and my oxygen tank has been damaged by the explosion. I think this might be the end for me. Wait. I know. I trust Command to save us. There's something on the other side of the portal, looks like an abandoned base. Please send help. Halski out.
As she uttered the words, Borrelia jumps into the bubble off frozen time at the side of the portal, joining everybody else. The transmission continued for 3 days without any change until the signal was lost. The end.